הוא שירת חמישה נשיאים בארצות הברית, הוא אחד האנשים הכי מרכזיים בתהליך השלום, שעוד היה אחד כזה, ולפני חודשיים הוא עזב את תפקידו בבית הלבן כיועץ מיוחד לברק אובמה. הוא עסק אז בעיקר בעניין האיראני. עכשיו הוא אומר לנו בריאיון, תסמכו על הנשיא, תסמכו על ארצות הברית, ותנו הזדמנות ללחץ הדיפלומטי על איראן.
What do you think are the chances that this coming year there will be a military strike on Iran nuclear facilities?
Well, I don't think that they're necessarily high. I say that because what we see happening right now is a strategy that is succeeding in putting significant pressure on the Iranians. If the pressures on them are significant as they regard those pressures, then if you look historically, you'll find that when the pressures have been intense on them, they look for a way out.
But after years of deceiving, don't you think they will use this path of negotiation to keep doing what they're doing, but in the hiding?
Their currency right now is fluctuating. They're facing the prospect of a serious loss of revenue. They already were facing very difficult problems in terms of doing business internationally, getting a line of credit. My point here is they may try to, you know, somehow deceive and use talks and continue the program, but the pressure keeps going up on them. It doesn't go down. The only way they can relieve the pressure is by seeking the way out.
In the current situation where crippling sanction has been imposed or starting to be imposed, yes. Do you think Israel has the legitimacy to strike militarily?
This has never been a case of Israel against Iran. This has been a case of the world against Iran. Israel has always wanted the world to deal with this issue. Israel has basically said, if the world doesn't deal with the issue, then we don't have a choice. Right now, I think a context has been created. The defense minister of Israel says even the idea of a military strike is far off now. Let's give this new set of crippling sanctions a chance to work. I think there's time and space. If that's the case and you can see that it works, then that's the best outcome.
You know, many Israelis says, if it doesn't work, the sanctions, will President Obama will have the courage and the leadership to really go all the way against the nuclear facilities of Iran? What do you think?
Well, I think the following. This is a president who does what he says. You know, he went after Osama bin Laden. It wasn't an easy decision because of the uncertainties at the time where the operation had to be conducted, the risks associated with it, but he went anyway. The president has said he is determined to prevent Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons. He doesn't use his words carelessly. He doesn't say things idly. That's the objective.
The United States government now say to Israel, stop, don't surprise us?
I think it's fair to say that Israel has one true enduring friend internationally. One country it can count on, and that's the United States. We have never had a more effective, closer, or intense relationship in the security area with Israel than we have today. Given that relationship, you would expect that, you know, we shouldn't be surprised by actions that would affect American interests as well.
דניס רוס, כעת עמית מחקר של מכון וושינגטון ונשיא משותף של המכון לתכנון העם היהודי, צפה בתסכול בשנתיים האחרונות בקרב הפוליטי הפנימי בארצות הברית, שאליו הכניסו הרפובליקנים את עניין התמיכה בישראל.
What makes this relationship so special, so extraordinary, is that in fact it is a non-partisan relationship.
And you think that Prime Minister Netanyahu contributes to the fact that it became a political matter inside the United States?
No, I don't think so. I think that Prime Minister Netanyahu understands the last thing that Israel wants or should need or has an interest in is for Israel to become a political issue in the United States. If Israel becomes a partisan issue in the United States, ultimately that is not going to be good for Israel.
So what went wrong with President Obama? You know, he's doing so much for Israel, and yet he's been perceived not as a real friend, but sometimes maybe as an enemy.
And the notion that any American president could be an enemy of Israel, given what American presidents have done, including this particular American president, I don't fully understand it, I have to be honest. I mean, I've been around a long time. You would think I would understand a lot of things. Maybe there are times where the things that even I don't understand it. I know there's a convention...
Yeah, President Obama said to Sarkozy, when Sarkozy told him, you know, he's a liar, he said, you know, I need to deal with him almost every day.
That's a statement of fact. He needs to deal with them almost every day. Look, I'm not going to comment on what are certain kinds of conversations. And by the way, you're picking up what the other side said. You're not picking up necessarily what the president said. There's a reality here. The reality here is there's a lot of noise about the relationship. There's conventional wisdoms about the relationship. I look at the fundamentals on what matters. When Israel is in need or Israel is in trouble, the Prime Minister of Israel turns to the President of the United States and he's there.
You know, you are dealing with the peace process with the Palestinians for more than 20 years. Is the door still open?
Well, the door always has to be open because there's not an alternative.
Yeah, but it looked like it was closing since the days you were walking around here with the peace team and the Oslo Agreement initiative.
I was a lot younger then. look, it's not where I would like it to be. That's a fact.
Do you understand the notion on Israeli leadership saying, you know, the Arab world is being turned upside down? Maybe this is not the biggest opportunity to make compromises and bold step for peace.
You know, I understand that kind of thinking, but I don't agree with it. If you're seeing everything change around you, if you say, I'm going to hunker down, I'm going to do nothing, then you can't affect anything around you. You basically are the victim of whatever happens. Point two, if everything else is changing around you, you actually have an interest, at least with the Palestinians, not to have one more front. How many fronts can Israel deal with?
You know, people look at you and see that you resigned from your job at the White House. So that probably means that you didn't see that peace is coming through the window.
Well, I think it's fair to say I don't think that an immediate breakthrough is in the offing. But I know, and it's true everywhere, everybody assumes there's got to be some hidden reason. Why did he leave? I left because, and this is the absolute truth, and in your case, you've known me a while, so you know, I say what I mean. My wife made me promise when I came back in that I would stay for only 2 years.
You blame your wife for that?
She bears a big burden. We share everything. But look, the truth is, these jobs are temporary by nature. They're defined. You go in them for a short period of time. You work very hard in them. They're very demanding, but you do it for a short period of time. The jobs are temporary. My relationship with her is not temporary.
Now you're out of office. Do you feel free man?
I'm more relaxed. There's no doubt. I'm definitely more relaxed. And it's nice to be able to come to Israel and be more relaxed.
Thanks, Ross. Thank you very much for the interview.
Thank you very much.